Our speaker tonight, Stuart Hall. I first met him many years ago when he was one of the leaders of the University and Left Review periodical. And he has been all his life an active and creative socialist, working, I think, out of a Marxist tradition. He is now Professor of Sociology in the Open University. Like all good sociologists, he is a polymath. And like all the best sociologists, he is a Marxidextrous polymath. He brings and calls upon the Marxist tradition at many different points. In the host of articles and books which have appeared in the last few weeks to mark the centenary of Marx's death, one certainly of the best is Betty Matthews' edition of Marx 100 Years On. And in that volume, you will find an extremely important contribution from Stuart called The Problem of Ideology. And it's subtitled Marxism Without Guarantees. Stuart Hall.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I say first of all how honoured I am to be invited to deliver the first of the lectures in this series, how inadequate I feel to the task, how much I want to begin by saluting the courage of the Sheffield Council in inaugurating this occasion. We live in a society where liberty in the abstract is constantly revoked, provided no particular liberties are involved. Also one in which people are still under the illusion that it is the market which gave us the vote and the ability to assemble and to express ourselves and to join trade unions and to withdraw our labour and so on. And in that climate, I'm happy to contribute a touch on the side of the subversive ideas by taking part in an occasion which recognises the immensity of Marx's contribution to our thinking and the unmatched importance which he has had in world history since his life and death. Now, Sheffield is beginning to get something of a reputation of asking people to do the impossible, and this is one such occasion, the idea of, in an hour, trying to say what one really feels and thinks about Marx is an utterly impossible task, and I'm not going to attempt it. I'm going to speak about some things in Marx, about some of his ideas, and about some of the problems and questions which arise when we think about Marx's importance 100 years after his death. I'm not going to offer a comprehensive picture, and I don't offer the meaning of Marx, whatever that is, if indeed any such single object exists over which we wouldn't immediately break out into squabbling and dicing of death about it. This is some important things about Marx, and I offer them in the tradition with which I think he worked himself. That is to say, in an open and critical, and I hope revolutionary spirit. I ought to say something about my own credentials. My first encounter with Marx was in a sixth form history room in Kingston, Jamaica, where I was born. I was taught history by a red-haired Scot, he was very good at teaching me history, but he was also committed to the task of inoculating the colonial intelligentsia against subversive ideas. And so he came to the history room armed with two instruments for this task. One was a series of recordings of the collected speeches of Baldwin. And the second was a tiny series of pamphlets put out by the British Council on the terrors of Marxism and the horrors of the Soviet Union and so on. And like a good student, the more this stuff was poured at me, the more I thought, there's really something interesting here I can get hold of. And so I've been wrestling with and arguing with and over and about Marx ever since. I stress the point of wrestling. I think one has to wrestle with Marx, otherwise he simply brings his huge girth and that gigantic beard to bear on you, and you're absolutely overwhelmed by it. I once, in resisting a Marxist organization that was attempting to recruit me to membership, used to go nevertheless to their weekly and monthly meetings, at which a panoramic Marxist view of the world would be given, which would begin with the gigantic entities locked in class struggle on the world horizon, and end with who's going to sell the paper in Oxford on Saturday. And this notion that Marx, you know, somehow covers the entire globe, all one's thoughts, could tell us what to do yesterday and tomorrow and so on, requires engaging with him in fisticuffs. One has to fight him off in a certain sense. That testifies to his power, it testifies to his influence. There is no one comparable with Marx when one thinks of the billions of human beings on the earth today who live in states and societies which in some ways think they owe their inheritance to Marx and Marx's ideas. In that sense, he has profoundly transformed the world we live in, whether people like it or not. It's one of those sheer, stubborn facts of the history of the last 100 years that though Marx is very safely buried and dead in Highgate Cemetery, and I can tell you that, I went yesterday, and there he is, far down below the surface of the earth, and he's not planning a resurrection, nevertheless, his ideas just refuse to lie down and die beside him there. They are restless spirits. He talked about a specter. He is the specter haunting the world. And his appearance brings liberal-minded people out with their censorship stamps, and so on. It makes people go purple in the head, which is exactly what Marx wanted when he said, "My thoughts are intended to be a scandal and an abomination to bourgeoisdom," and here was a thought for me, especially bourgeois professors. So it's in that spirit, in the spirit of someone whose main ideas one has tried to fight with, whom one has tried to think with, whom one has sometimes to think beyond, that I approach him. And I urge anyone who is, as it were, interested in the topic to remember one important thing about him. He may be less or more important than Jesus Christ, but he is not Jesus Christ. He began with a critique of religion. He is a secularist spirit, and the notion of approaching him as if he is a kind of prophet, or his work as if it is, you know, old Moore's almanac or something, which has in it a recipe for everything that will come in 200 or 300 years. Think of the scandal Marx would have felt if you had said to him, "You are a historical materialist, and are you surprised to know that the working class in 1983 looks exactly as you left it in 1883? Well, he would have been profoundly astonished at this suspension of history. So the notion that we are engaging with someone who, as it were, had the whole of the future unrolled before him in some moment of divine inspiration is quite the wrong attack. The thing which I think people have not only wrestled with but had to come to terms with is something deeply embedded in Marx's life and in his approach, and something which indeed people have found difficult to understand and scandalous in a certain important way. And that is the fact of Marx's insistence on combining his contribution to scientific social theory with his deep and profound commitment to an emancipatory socialist politics. Now, we live in a world where intellectuals ought to be without political taint and political people ought to be without ideas. And that was a divide which Marx could not understand. He saw a world complex with a huge history which had to be understood, and the tools of understanding it had to be as complex as the history itself. And the purpose of doing that was to understand how the past had shaped the present so that we could make the future. And the idea that there would be some neat line which one could draw between the commitment to understanding and analysis and the commitment to revolutionary politics was something which Marx constantly denied. He denied it in his words, he denied it in his life. He was constantly oscillating and moving between those two roles. He made no division between them. Nevertheless, I think it is also true that we would be wrong if we approached Marx as if his work was a total, coherent, complete entity. We know that the majority of his mature works are incomplete. We would be wrong if we approached him as if his life was without contradiction in itself, or if we thought that his work didn't contain, as one moved from different phases of his life, to very different emphases. So in one sense, while we recognize the importance and the stature of Marx, I think we want to remember
but he was a man. He was a man with all the faults and admixtures as a personal human being of other people that we have known. He's not a demigod. It is in the destruction of demigods that Marx comes into his own. Very briefly, I want to say a word or two about his life and his biography. I don't want to spend a lot of time on that, but I think it's important to get a sense of the man in his own time. He was born in the Rhineland in Prussia in 1818 in Trier. Grandfathers who were rabbis. He went to the University of Berlin in the Faculty of Law, where they seem to teach very different things from what they teach in the Faculty of Laws these days. And there, especially in Berlin, he encountered the left Hegelians. It is his first encounter with Hegelian philosophy, and it's important that Marx, in a formative period of his life, comes into Hegelian philosophy from the radical side. He's already involved in a critique of Hegelian idealism, while he's learning something about the profound importance of seeing history as a movement, seeing history as a coherent development, not as a series of odd contingent events. And yet, he comes into that engagement in a critical spirit. He becomes a contributor and an editor to a liberal newspaper, which, like all good liberal newspapers, is then suppressed by the censorship. Marx moves on. He goes to Paris. In Paris, he looks at and begins to study the birth of bourgeois society in its most Jacobin phase. And one of the things that I want to remind you about Marx and capitalism, in case you ever forget it, is that Marx had the most profound respect for capitalism and the bourgeoisie, especially in its heroic moments. After all, it was capitalism which had broken asunder the old, feudal, stable, static world. It was capitalism which was the dynamic, thrusting system that had already begun to revolutionize European and world society. When Marx wanted to, as it were, surpass capitalism, to move to the next and higher stage of civilization, he thought of that revolution as having been made on the backs of those who had already begun to revolutionize society in their own way. The French Revolution, though it's not a subject on which Marx wrote extensively, was a very important subject of his thinking. But it's in that period that he begins to be engaged in the political movements and developments of his time. And there begins Marx the great arguer. Marx in argument with Proudhon. Marx in argument with the anarchist Bakunin. Marx, first of all, may I remind you, since it's the birth of a long and profound and profoundly important friendship with Engels, beginning that friendship by disagreeing with him. Marx was very good beginning things by disagreeing with people, and he went on being very good at disagreeing with people whom he thought were on the wrong track. So he begins with an engagement, with a wrestle with Engels, before, after a very, very long conversation, one of those kinds of conversations which still, I hope, go on in socialist circles, the two fight themselves to discovering that they actually quite agree. And they're going to agree for a very long time, and it's going to be a friendship which yields immensely fruitful joint work and thought. It's a remarkable alliance and friendship, an immensely productive alliance and friendship. And it's a point where the skin of Hegelian philosophy begins to fall off, and where Marx really doesn't invoke history with a big H, but actually begins to think about the world in historical categories. And it's when we hear historical categories in Marx's writing beginning to come through as things with which he can actually see and organize what he's learning about the world. Well, expulsion again. He moves on, this time with Engels' help, and he moves to Brussels. He's involved in the network of communist correspondents and socialist correspondents there through the League. But especially in terms of his own work, it's a period when historical materialism, which I'm going to say something about later, it's when historical materialism begins to be a real system. It's when Marx, as he says, settles his accounts with his erstwhile philosophical conscience and begins to talk about the real world, not in abstract and idealist categories, but in the recognition that the world is made by men's practice under certain conditions, that the name of those conditions is history itself. it is possible to use history to unlock the message of the past in order to understand the grounds on which the present has to be struggled for. In 1848, he's invited back to revolutionary Paris, and he also goes to Germany, but he sees the counter-revolution as well. And it's a period when he comes to understand important things about the class struggle, also to overestimate its speed and tempo. Marx is not the first socialist to do that. Slightly to overestimate its speed and tempo, to fall back to a deeper analysis, to fall back to a deeper analysis, a very important socialist moment, not losing his essential faith in what he was doing, not losing his sense of the importance of the working class, not losing his long-term perspective, but knowing when it is right to think again about the tactics which have been employed, to come at it another way, knowing when the moment is to go into the libraries. Well, when you need to go into the libraries, you go to the best library there is, and that is the moment when Marx comes to England, not out of his own will and accord, but has to. He lives in several places in London, in Camberwell, in Dean Street. He's making a very pittancy kind of living as a journalist for the Daily Tribune. He's every now and again relieved from dire poverty by handouts from Engels. He's working hard with his international contacts, but it is the time when the deep and profound work that he does on the nature of English capitalism, on the laws of motion of English capitalism, begin to be unlocked. This is a time when Marx is working constantly between his engagement and involvement in building an international socialist movement, and at the same time, in what appears to be highly abstract and theoretical work on the nature of capitalism itself. Now, the capacity, I'm going to pause there for a moment, because the capacity to hold those two ends of the chain together is something which the socialist movement has on many occasions lost. We have, I suspect, most people in this room have been in the divide when the doers have slagged off the thinkers and vice versa. When the unity of theory and practice has been evoked as if it comes down from heaven in a large balloon, but when actually confronting its failure to meet and join up every moment of the day, the movement has fallen back either into a kind of mindless anti-intellectualism or into a mindless speculativeness, philosophical abstraction. Well, Marx, you know, made one error, one profound error in his introduction to Capital. He's apologizing for putting before the working class this huge and difficult and abstract and complex tome. And he thinks to himself, I hope every good socialist has thought to themselves, how can I popularize this a bit? Should I do a cartoon or put it out in a series or simplify the graphs? How can I reach the people? And he has to confess that you can't unlock the secrets of modern capitalism in quite so simple a way. There simply, as he says, isn't a royal road to science. And he feels at the back of him, pressing on him, the need to popularize and to engage. And he says, the main need is coming from the French, who are always urgent to come to the end of a problem. Well, I think Marxists who have been involved in French intellectual and theoretical work in the last 20 years are not absolutely convinced that the French are always dying to come to the end of a conclusion. So he may have been wrong about that, but he wasn't wrong about the difficulties, the problems of trying to bring this difficult and complex work. If you read volume 2, you know what I mean. Complicated work, essential but complicated and difficult thinking. And to say to people, this is the Bible of the working class movement. And that's what he did. That's what he was saying. And his work for the International and the work on completing the first volume of Capital are going on hand in hand. He's working on building the movement without which the words mean nothing. But he is involved in writing the words, and he's involved in revising them and trying to make them right. He's involved in testing the formulae. He's involved in wrestling with difficult ideas and making ideas come alive for people. And that combination is something which is essential to Marx in this period. In the final phase, it's mainly a phase where he is continuing to do his intellectual labors, but where he's caught again in the struggle in Europe. That's in the Franco-Prussian War, and in the resistance to the provisional government, and in the Paris Commune, and in its destruction. It's a very important moment for Marx and for Marxists, because it is one of the essential statements we have from Marx, and there are very few, about what he thought socialism would be like. I think it's worthwhile asking ourselves why Marx's greatest book is called Capital, not Socialism. Why didn't he write a big book called Socialism? Well, speculative and ex-Hegelian as he was, he thought that that was something which, apart from a few indications, was very difficult to put a blueprint on, which wouldn't be, as it were, hopelessly utopian. But it wasn't only that. It was because Marx understood that socialism would come out of and would be profoundly formed by the capitalism that it was destroying. And consequently, it was necessary to understand those conditions in order to see what would give rise to the possibilities of another civilization, another level of civilization. So in that sense, Marx makes very little of a distinction between analyzing what exists and the prophecies and predictions about what should come. And I want to come back and say something about that in a moment, too. He's at this period regularly ill, with a large family to keep. He gets a regular income now from Engels, who is a quite successful small capitalist of his own. That should make you think, too, about the adaptability and opportunism of some of the greatest Marxists alive, who are always certain that they're going to stay alive for the day when they can be useful. Yes. I don't know whether any of you know what Engels' factory looks like now. It still exists. It's a number of tiny workshops, some of them still virtually artisanal, and others which are full of things where people make things without doing any work at all. You know, those 21st century industries. Everything, the whole relay of the whole history of capitalism is in that backyard that Engels worked on to pass some money to Marx so that Marx could write how that would finish and end. But that's the contradiction. Marx would, if he'd had the time and good health to think about it, he would have relished the thought that the money was, as it were, passing through the guts of capitalism and coming out on what he would have thought of as the bad side, the wrong side, financing socialism, as it were, out of the operations of petty capitalism. Very important process. It kept him alive until the death of his wife and his own illness. He died in an armchair, peacefully, in 1883. I've said something about his life and biography just simply to remind you that Marx belongs with a certain time, he belongs with a certain history. The way in which he wrote is thought of and shaped by the experiences he had. When he speaks of the class struggle, he has particular images in his mind. He has moments when he has seen the working class organized. He has moments when he has seen the working class disorganized. He has seen the beginnings of the revolution and the counter-revolution. He is not a... It's not a machine we are dealing with. It's a man in a time with a real history, real movements, real setbacks, looking at capitalism at a particular phase. One has to establish him in that time. To talk about the founder of historical materialism outside of history is to conjure up the wrong image. What he left behind is an inspiration, is an example, and is his ideas. I'm going to say something about some of his ideas. And if one thinks now about what it is that Marx left behind which is important to us, I would say that there are many things, many individual insights, but there are three major contributions I want to single out. He left behind a schema of historical explanation and analysis, one which he used and which is still of use and importance to us. Secondly, he left behind a method by which one might begin to analyze society, social processes. And thirdly, and particularly, he left behind us a profound understanding of the dynamics of capitalist societies. That is his special contribution. That is what his major work is about. It is about capitalism that Marx is profoundly insightful. Now, that scheme of history has been discussed at length in other places, and I don't want simply to repeat it, but I want to say a little bit about the whole framework within which Marx analyzed historical developments, simply because I think it is sometimes so dry and remote from us when we read it in the textbooks and so on, that we can't see how one might put it in language which we can ordinarily understand. It's a very profound historical insight, but it doesn't seem to be impossible to understand or to communicate to others. He'd come out of the clouds of idealism, and he'd understood that history has to be taught and told and analyzed in terms of how people socially and materially organize themselves. That's the starting point. And if you want to start somewhere else, you can do things with Marx, but not a great deal. If you want to start with the human history as the march of great ideas or the procession of great historical figures, you better start somewhere else. Because Marx's importance is, can the history of human society be thought in terms of the material conditions under which people live? And looking at that society across historical time, he sees that, of course, people have to create the conditions and circumstances by which they live. But that doesn't happen just like that. They do it in a particular way. And the way in which human beings organize themselves socially so as to produce their existence, whether that's a simple existence of a peasant society or the complex existence of modern 20th and 21st capitalism, doesn't matter. What matters is the way in which human beings organize themselves socially to produce and reproduce themselves materially and historically. And what he said was, if you look at that, you see great differences between the ways in which, say, a feudal society organizes its material life and the way in which capitalism does. And the difference between that is not just a difference of its economy, it's a difference which stamps the whole of the society. Its politics, its religion, its ideas, its social relationships will be affected by that set of complex organizations which human beings have developed through history. That is what defines one mode of production against another, one epoch against another. And what he was interested in, since he was interested in capitalism and socialism, and to some extent feudalism, he wanted to know how society got from one kind of organization to another kind of organization. Well, so far there's nothing particularly subversive about that, so Marx, going back over that picture, then says, well, but they don't just organize themselves peacefully. Can we get together and do a little work here? You go out and fish and I'll stay home. Actually, what happens is that the process of labor by which that occurs, the process of organizing social labor, has been done in all the developed societies we know of in a very particular way, so that some people, through their labor, produce this great, enormous kinds of human wealth, and that's not just material wealth, but intellectual and spiritual wealth, which belongs to the class that possesses. So the whole, largely the majority of any of those societies, and that's slave society, it's feudal society, it's capitalist society. In each of them, in different ways, the majorities are laboring to produce that which is, let me use the idiom, creamed off by those who have the rights of possession over it. Different kinds of possessions under feudalism and capitalism, but the same dynamic of people whose labor is creamed off, sucked off by the system, and the class, the layer, which lies on top of that system, which enjoys the fruits of the labor of others. And that is why the subversive part of Marx is that social organization depends on exploitation. When you say exploitation, people begin to lose their moral rag. And you have to understand that when Marx said exploitation, he meant two things. He meant one thing which was very cool indeed. Whatever you think about it, that's how it works. You are exploited, whether you feel exploited today or not. You may feel deeply entrenched in your work, fully identified with it. But if you just look at the objective relationships in which you are situated, You like it, but you are being creamed off nonetheless. In that sense, analytically, Marx was quite cool about exploitation. It's just what happened to happen in slave societies and feudal societies and other capitalists. On the other hand, the other side of Marx, the active side of Marx, understood profoundly what exploitation had meant in history and how this cool process I've just described was, as he said in another place, actually written and inscribed in the blood and sweat of human beings. Now, it's only when you see those two sides of exploitation, exploitation as describing what happens in a society, when I'm talking about, you know, when capitalists are good, humane, liberal, not when they're top-hatted with shotguns. Shotgun-armed, top-hatted capitalists one can recognize. It's the cool, humane ones who simply are exploiting human labor. That's their task, that's their historical function. When Marx was trying to keep his cool at the beginning of Capital, he said, I'm not talking about any particular capitalist. I'm not even talking about my friend Engels. I'm talking about the function of capitalism and the function of labor in such societies. It's an extremely important point that, because when we want to know now what is the meaning of Marx 100 years later, we are frequently very confused unless the actors of his drama come on in the disguise that we're accustomed to seeing them in. If the working class doesn't look exactly like the woodcuts in Engels's Conditions of the Working Class in 1844, we think they must have disappeared, gone somewhere else. And if the capitalists now don't have their top hats on, etc., you think, well, perhaps they've been absorbed into management or post-industrial something, etc. But Marx isn't talking about the particular people. He isn't talking about this capitalist in 1844. He's talking about a system which has a function of the capitalist, which can be performed by vast corporations, and the function of the worker, which can be performed by two people in front of a modern machine. So the question of whether Marx's images and analysis of capitalism is applicable to the 20th century can't be done by substituting the images of the 19th century and then wondering where he's gone to. You have to ask whether the function of capitalism has been surpassed in the 20th century. And you may believe it is, but believe me, Mrs. Thatcher doesn't. She certainly knows it's a capitalist society in which the function of capital accumulation and profitability is the absolute rock bottom of the society. When Mr. Teviot says he wants to lower the value of labor power, I don't care whether he knows where the phrase comes from. What he is doing is performing the function which the capitalist, and since then the state, has performed in relation to the exploitation of labor. The thing we have to understand about Marx in relation to the present is to stop being literal about it, to stop wanting it to be exactly as the old man sitting down in his study in 1860 might have glimpsed the future. We have to ask whether the analysis stands up, whether we can use the analysis to understand what is actually happening in modern-day capitalism, and indeed, we have to ask the question whether there is any more adequate starting point for understanding what is going on in modern capitalism. If it has developed or transformed itself to the point where Marx's categories no longer allow us to come to grips with it, what are we doing with it? It's a fossil, it's a historical excrescence. Put it in the library, put it in a monument, put it in a glass case, but don't continue to think with it. People continue to think with Marxism because there is no better starting point for understanding what capitalism is about. Even when Marx was wrong, and he was often wrong about particular features of capitalism, he was right about the questions that he asked about how the system works. And that is the contribution which that schema made, and which is why people who disagree often with this and that piece of Marx's writings continue to go back to him and find themselves profoundly impressed and deepened in their understanding by it. Now, that work, the work of analysis on history, the work of analysis on the nature of capitalism, was produced in that grand systematic way which Victorian writers had. You can see it in Carlyle, you can see it in Freud, you can see it in Hegel, you can see it in Darwin, the unwinding of a great system. Patient with the unwinding of great systems now. You can see that it's based on a kind of conviction that Marx gets about the fact that he's right, and therefore about the inevitability of the tasks that he's unlocking. You can see him pushed from time to time into very important prophecies and predictions, which were incorrect. Marx is incorrect in the Communist Manifesto about the speed at which the society will polarize into two classes. He is incorrect about how rapidly the class struggle is beginning. In 1848, he goes back and says, I mistook the birth pangs of capitalism for its death throes. That's a big mistake. That's a big mistake. And I'm afraid to say Marxists have gone on being quite wrong about their actual predictions about what's going to happen next year, and longer than that. The error which is made after the October Revolution, that capitalism is entering its moribund phase, whereas in that period, on the back of recession, capitalism is actually restructuring itself, putting itself together again. And the ebbing of that revolutionary tide and the strength of reformism and the consequent isolation of the Soviet Union has had the most profound impact on the history of socialism itself. Yeah, so when we get into the area of predictions, of literal predictions about what is coming next, we have to be on our guard. There is a tendency, sometimes in addition to that, to abstract the logic of events from a sort of reading of the infrastructure of the economy, to think that that has a kind of key which you will turn and unlock a whole chain of events forward. It's a mistake, it's a kind of error of thinking into which Marx himself does actually fall. It's a set of errors which the moments very shortly after Marx's death, Engels has to go back over and correct. He says they come from overemphases, from emphasizing the materialist and the importance of economic things and perhaps neglecting others. These are not thinkers that are locked into their structure forever. And the glosses on Marx's and Engels's work, which is provided in the correspondence of Engels after Marx's death, which leads to the recognition that in some respects, Marx himself would have distanced himself from the dogmatics of those who go around calling themselves Marxists. That is a very important moment in the history of Marxism, and reminds us of the possibilities of error and mistakes, of taking the wrong lead and going in the wrong direction. That is not only true about some of the economic aspects, it is also true about the importance of political struggles. Let me say a word about that, because it is another point at which what we can understand about Marx has a bearing on what we understand about contemporary politics. It is about the degree to which the economic things, the economic basis of capitalism, is capable of determining the whole structure of political and social life. Now, it seems to me that when we understand that, in what has often been the form in which Marx's predictions have been understood in the Marxist movement, namely that there is a kind of moment, sometimes called in the last instance, whenever that is, when something called the economy, which we engage with and encounter all over the bloody shop, suddenly detaches itself and marches ahead of us and says, let me tell you what all this is going to lead to. Collapse in socialism. Well, if that's where we're going, why didn't we know it before? And if the end is known, why do we have to do anything at all? You know that bind, that double bind, which Marxists get themselves into. If it's science, you don't need to do anything. Just stand aside and let the inevitable historical laws roll. And yet when you look around, there are the socialists and Marxists and communists rushing after one another, trying to influence these apparently inevitable laws. Well, if you use the notion of economic determination as if it is somebody with a big key who has the key to the understanding of the future, who can tell you when and where the current political struggle is going to end up, and who will walk round to the front door and say, stop, this is the resolution, believe me, you are, I think, true in some respects to emphases which Marx occasionally gave, but you are untrue, in my reading, to Marx's intrinsic spirit of analysis. If you read the class struggles in France, or you read the 18th Brumaire, if you read when Marx is trying to describe what is actually going on in particular political struggles, you know that that is not the relationship he understands between economics and politics. What he understands by the economic determinations is to convince people of the givenness of the terrain on which they struggle. What Marx wants to insist on to you is that no one enters political struggle with a tabula rasa, with a free table, and can do and go where they like. That the past has set limits, that the present position within capitalism establishes determinations, and that we have to move and work and struggle politically within that framework. That is the determinateness of human struggle, of political struggle. What he does not say is that the end of the struggle is already wrapped up and determined by some abstract economic law. Otherwise, what would be the point of engaging in struggle? Well, those two parts of Marx, which have constantly been split apart, one has to put together again. The essential determinateness of the ground on which politics works and the open-endedness of political struggle. One has to be committed to the notion that the struggle, in the right circumstances, effectively waged and properly understood, can lead to different effects from those which would have happened in another set of circumstances. Marx is committed, I believe, to the notion that struggle is determinate, but that it is open-ended. And with that, one brings together aspects of economic analysis and political struggle, which are very different from the normal ways in which those two sides of Marx, the scientist and the political agitator and activist, are normally understood. Let me say something finally about two aspects. And here I want to come out of trying to say something about what Marx was doing in his own time, in relation to his own circumstances, and ask something about the reverberations of Marx 100 years later. And I want to put to that Marx that I've been trying to evoke, nothing more, two hard sets of questions. It's not worth facing geniuses with simple questions. It's only worth facing them with tough ones. If Marx can't survive the tough ones, he's not worth thinking about as an active presence in the 20th century. He's simply a historical figure. Well, the two hard questions I want to ask of Marx is, 100 years later, is Marx in the face of actual existing socialism? And I want to ask about Marx in the face of actual existing capitalism. And I ask about the first, because after all, it is the construction of socialism, it is the transition to socialism that Marx believed would be the results of the generation of conflicts and contradictions inside of capitalism. What is the point of analyzing those contradictions unless it was going to lead both objectively and subjectively, that is to say, both in its determinateness and in its forms of struggle, to the construction of a society more just, more equitable, and not only that, different in its integral structure, different in its feel and quality of life from anything known under capitalism. And I have to say to you, I think that is not what the experience is under actual existing socialism. And I have to say to you that those Marx's notions of that socialism were sketchy. He was seriously underplaying the deep persistence of the state. He knew the state himself. He knew that one kind of state had to be smashed, to be disintegrated and supplanted. He knew that there would have to be a difficult time in which that transition to another kind of society constructed and constituted its own kind of state. But he thought it would disappear faster than communism that he looks forward to in the commune and elsewhere is a communism of self-disciplining and self-organizing human beings. It's human beings who have come into the mastery of their own situation. It's human beings who see in the objective world they're able to produce in their labor and relationships a proper, a not distorted image of their humanity. It's a fantastic vision that Marx has, which, just as an aside, let me say, has nothing whatever to do with the current psychological notions of alienation. Marx's alienation is not a hang-up inside. It's the lack of a relationship with the objective world. It is that we don't possess that world we have all built together in an open interchange. It's not inside. It may be that we're alienated inside because we don't have that objective relationship. But Marx is not about feeling good in our heads. It's about holding on to the world. It's about having the world at our disposal. His reading of human history is that we have been disposed of by history. And the notion of socialism is a notion of a time when men and women will dispose of history and nature and the material world. And in that sense, it will be their instrument, the instrument of their realization, their fulfillment. Now, that is the dream which activates socialists everywhere. If you don't have a touch of that in you, well, it is the dream. And without that, I don't understand what socialism is. It's not easy. It's patently in the face of actually what has actually happened, often in the name of Marx and Marxism. It is not easy to achieve. And I have to say to you that my own feeling, my own personal sentiment, is that that caricature of socialism has been one of the most profound impediments to the development of socialism and of Marxism in the world. It is what people see that socialism has apparently become under particular historical circumstances, which makes them lose the capacity to believe in that particular future. Now, that doesn't rule Marx out of that equation, because I think if you understand that reality, you will see that unevenly, in under conditions often of deep repression, the notion of the class struggle under actual existing socialism has not been suspended. As Marx would say, the old mole of revolution is still operating inside what calls itself communism. The Marxists in the Kremlin may be finished with Marx, but Marx is not finished with them. The historical process has not stopped in Poland, in Czechoslovakia, in Hungary. It has not stopped in the Soviet Union. It may be in a deep freeze, but the notions of the laws of social relations, of how the goods, the surplus is accumulated and by whom it is expropriated, and the points at which workers will revolt, if necessary, apparently illogically, against a workers' state in order to take the historical development on, is something which goes on, which has not ceased, and which Marx has some of the greatest and most profound insights into. I don't want to make easy assessments now about whether Marx would have been with Solidarity or not. I want to say that I understand Marxism only in the sense in which Marxism can still be applied and unravel some of the complexities of what is going on in societies of that type. But the difficult one, the tricky one, the $174 one, is after all about us. That long tour d'horizon has brought us back to good old Sheffield, 1983, with all the, one of the virtues and values of historical analysis is that you take that grand sweep, you know, you see 1848 rising and falling, you see in the 80th Brumaire, which is an absolutely magnificent text, it's one of the most wonderful texts in the world, where Marx is talking about the constant unrolling of one alliance with the other, yes, as the French state quietly emerges in the background as the real power that's going to consolidate and further develop capitalism. You see what the dialectic means, which has absolutely nothing to do with Hegel's synthesis, great lumping synthesis and antithesis, and it has everything to do with the ability to conceive contradiction, to see things two-sidedly, to know, as Brecht said, that things develop from their bad side, not from their good side. If you ask me to define the difference between a Marxist and a reformist, I would say reformists always imagine that history proceeds by the good side. It was good then, and then it improved, and it got a little bit better. Whereas Marx always wants to say, got better? Aha! What about the negative side? Or he asks you about the negative side, what was positively constructed in that? You tell him about repression, and he will say, those are the conditions under which capitalism restructures. He's always asking about the side you haven't seen. That is why Marx has an imagination grounded in the understanding of historical contradiction. So all of that one can see on the historical scale, but when one has to confront, as it were, a contradiction in one's own backyard, then the difficulties and problems begin. I think any of us could give a list of the number of important aspects and elements of which Marx might have treated and discussed, which we would have expected to go differently from the way in which they have gone under advanced and developed capitalism. He misread the degree to which capitalism would be able to stabilize itself. He underestimated the profound impact of reformism in the labor movement. He expected a much closer relationship between the development of economic circumstances and the consciousness of the working class. He thought the capital-labor contradiction would unlock virtually everything. If he didn't think so, Marxists in his wake have thought so. And what we have to confront are quite different things from that. A capitalism which, in our lifetime, has stabilized and destabilized itself. A workers' movement in the Western, developed, advanced world which has been profoundly locked into reformist politics. New forms of social movement which have arisen from contradictions which are not easily assimilated to or reduced to the contradiction between capital and labor. One of the most important perspectives in Marx was that the development of capitalism would lead to the winnowing away of all those other factors that got between the pure essence of the struggle between capital and labor. Whereas in our messy world, what we understand is that capital and labor do not go in that clean, neat way. The ethnic composition of the working class, the structure and stratification of the working class, the gender composition of the working class, are impediments to the unity of the class more real and more profound in advanced capitalism than it was in the early stages. So that if one goes back to Marx, you know, to pick up the instruments and find in the 20th century a kind of easy checklist. Yes, there is the joint stock company. It's now multinational, but it's roughly recognized. And the welfare state, well, he wouldn't have understood about that. You'd have had to tell him about the 10-hour day. And he would have said about that. An advance and a retreat. It put the working class ahead, and it made capitalism develop in another way. What has your welfare state done? Don't ask me whether you could go out and fight for it. Of course, you fight for the victories of the class, but in the long term, well, there are all kinds of ways in which you can bring Marx to bear on the problems of the 20th century. The one thing I think you cannot do is to ask Marx to be right about everything in the 20th century. To ask him to be right about it, rather than to ask him where to start to understand it, is to approach Marx from the wrong side. It's to ask him to be correct, whereas Marx was analytic and profound, sometimes wrong. You see, if you set up the agenda of understanding the complexities of capitalism and the possibilities of socialism in the 20th century, you could find Marx right about some things and wrong about others. But the list of questions you would have to ask are Marx's. They're his agenda. That is where you start. If you want to say what has happened to the class struggle, you have first of all to ask the class question. If you want to know what has happened to capital accumulation, you have to understand the intrinsic importance of the capital accumulation process, and then say, in the 20th century, because of so and so and so, that process is partly done by the state. The very differences between 20th and 19th century capitalism become more important in the light of Marx's agenda. Therefore, what I want to say about Marx in conclusion in relation to the modern world 100 years later is not to claim for him profound insight into what happened 150 years. It's not to claim that he was always right. It's not to claim that his predictions were perfect. It is to claim that I know of nowhere else to start the analysis of modern contemporary reality. It is to claim the centrality of Marx's agenda, his questions. It is to claim the importance of his inspiration. It's to claim the absolutely vital importance of that relationship between analysis and practice, between bringing an understanding of the world to bear on the practice of making it different. It is, above all, to salute Marx's critical and revolutionary spirit. One of the things Marx would never do was to take the given, the common sense, for granted. There was only one thing to do with what everybody agreed, and that is to disagree with it, to question it, to open it up, and to take the scalpel to it. That meant long, hard hours in the British Museum. I don't know how many of you know how hard those seats are. Yes, long, difficult hours to prize the box of capitalism open. But what Marx said to us was not, come here, my children, and believe in me. He said, use my tools and do some work. He said, the world is there to be understood and transformed. I didn't get very far by 1883, and you ain't come so far by 1993, but let us do something with the tools we have. Marx offered us the instruments for beginning to analyze historical reality. What more does one want him to do? Rise in a puff of smoke? He has performed his historical task. He's put ideas in our heads. He's made us reject some of his own ideas. He's brought us into confrontation with them. We are arguing with him all the time in order to figure out how the world works. That is the challenge of a very profound thinker. It is also, since what he was talking about was capitalism and socialism, the challenge of a very profound revolutionary socialist. That is his legacy to us today. He asks not for the security of science, but for the openness of a revolutionary practice which is informed by his ideas, among others. Lonely scholars can't take that up, but socialist movements can.